Welcome to the Kandid shop. We speaking on things you not. Just press play and let it rock. Hey, welcome to the Kandid shop. Whoa. Welcome to the Kandid shop. We speaking on things you not. Just press play and let it rock. Hey, welcome to the Kandid shop. Whoa. Feel like we going through mad things. Gotta keep it real when they choose not. We gonna talk about it when the news drop. Welcome to the show where you know we don't fake this. Keep your opinion to yourself if it don't make sense.
Hola, Podcast Nation. It's your girl, Candidly Kristen, and this is The Kandid Shop, your number one destination for candid conversations. Tonight's episode is sponsored by Ausome Swag Apparel. That's Ausome spelled A-U-S-O-M. If you want to grab some dope merchandise with a message, head over to www.ausomeswag.com. And until the end of April, you'll get $10 off any order over $25. So go grab you some merchandise from Ausome Swag. So today is Autism Awareness Month. And tonight we'll be talking about Autism Spectrum Disorder or ASD. This is a very personal topic to me and my family. So I am excited to have this candid conversation. Joining me for this important discussion are Neurodiversity trainer, certified purpose coach, certified autism specialist, and founder of Akili's Corner, Akili Atkinson. Akili says that purpose and passion drive her work. My second guest is Mrs. Chanel McGriff-Salk. Chanel is a stay-at-home mom, personal caregiver to her mom, my sister, and the founder of this episode's sponsor, Ausome Swag. Ausome Swag is a brand created to honor and celebrate the awesomeness of her son and my grandnephew, Jaden, who was diagnosed with ASD at age 2. Swag is an acronym for sincere, wise, accepting, and giving. So welcome, 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 ladies, to the Kandid Shop.
Hello, hello, hello.
Hello, hello. Thank you for having me.
Oh, I'm so glad you both made it and you're here and we're having this conversation while it's still April because it's Autism Awareness Month. So I'm going to start with some stats. Now, when I went to autismspeaks.org, the stats, there were so many stats. I mean, they got stats on stats on stats. So I'm not going to read all of them. I'm just going to hit on some of the bigger ones. So in terms of prevalence, according to the CDC in 2021, approximately 1 in 44 children in the U.S. is diagnosed with an autism spectrum disorder. And that's based on 2018 data. 1 in 27 boys identified with autism and 1 in 116 girls identified with autism. Boys are 4 times more likely to be diagnosed than girls. And many children were still being diagnosed after 4, though autism can be reliably diagnosed as early as age 2. Autism affects all ethnic and socioeconomic groups, though minority groups tend to be diagnosed later and less often. There is no medical detection for autism. So ladies, I think I'd like to start by just asking you each to briefly share your stories as it relates to autism or ASD or neurodiversity. And Akili, you go first.
Thank you so much. My story, you said brief, it started 31 years ago with my son. Okay. He was diagnosed as Asperger's syndrome back then and now defined as ASD. Mm-hmm. We were on a military base and nobody knew what this meant. And this is before Google, before mm-hmm. you had this community to help you. Right. I had to start on this trek to figure out what to do, what this means, and how this looks for our future. So in a short version, it started because I had a need to learn and right. I needed to figure it out. And it led to me figuring out this is way bigger than my son. This mm-hmm. is about so many other people and figuring out how to help them.
Yeah. Yeah. And Chanel, I kind of know your story, but share it with my listeners.
Yes. My journey started back in 2016 when my son, it was about 4 days before his second birthday. From the time he was born, we always knew that he was a little bit delayed. Mm-hmm. We didn't exactly know what, at first it was just global developmental delay. But mm-hmm. then as he got older, he started to show more signs. And so his pediatrician just wanted to have him evaluated by a developmental pediatrician. Okay. So we went in and I kind of in the back of my mind knew what they were going to say at the end of the appointment before they said it. Mm-hmm. Because I do have a background in psychology. So I kind of knew some of the signs and symptoms, but it just, we didn't have a name at that point in time for what was actually going on with him. Mm-hmm. So to go and see the developmental pediatrician and to actually get a diagnosis was like a huge weight off my shoulders because I had a name to go with everything that had been going on with him.
Right.
From the time, you know, basically from the time he was born.
Right.
And, you know, he's 8 years old now. He's thriving.
Yeah.
And it's because it was detected so early that he is doing as great as he is. He actually last week just graduated from outpatient speech therapy.
Nice.
And this is the same therapist that has been working with him since he was 20 months old.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah. So isn't that amazing? Yay. I wish I had my clap. See, I missed that from Podbean.
Yes.
So Akili, your son was diagnosed with Asperger's, and I know the little bit that I know most of what I know now because of Chanel and Jaden, because it was, you know, she's my niece, she's my sister's daughter. And so Jaden is naturally, they're my immediate family. So we needed to learn some things as well, because we spend a lot of time around each other. So the shift from to the autism spectrum disorder, how did that happen and what does that mean? Because there are, from what I see, there are so many iterations of autism, like no two look alike.
Yes. Yeah, so switching over to autism spectrum disorder is, in my opinion, a kind of frustration. It would be like if someone was in a wheelchair and then you just said everybody had the same disability because they were in a wheelchair.
Right.
It doesn't allow autism to move and breathe among people. If you see my son, he's a college graduate. He's doing his thing. Life looks good. Mm-hmm. But it has nothing to do with the social aspect or the anxiety he faces, those things that aren't seen. But right. because the initial diagnosis now is autism, people would say, oh, he's fine. But back then it was understood that Asperger's, although presents as intellectually aware, there's mm-hmm. a whole realm of social that is non-existent or limited. And right. so we don't have those clear definitions anymore or those delineations between different diagnoses. And I think that makes it confusing for the regular folks, the people that just don't know anything about it. It's big and it's confusing. You're saying one out of 44. Can you imagine?
Yeah.
Though every one of those has a different diagnosis.
Yep.
Technically. Because the autism itself is their diagnosis, but there's so many layers to that and comorbidities. Yes, I could go on forever on that one.
right. So tell me, do we know what causes autism? Is it a combination of environmental, genetic? Is there a specific marker for it?
So we have no known diagnosis, but you can listen to stories from people. Mm-hmm. I was 22 years old when I had my son, and I was without my amniotic fluid for over 48 hours. I was to deliver a stillborn child. That was what the doctor told me. There was no viable heartbeat. And when he came out, he had a considerable lack of oxygen to his brain. And okay. I got to see him, 2 days later in the ICU. Mm-hmm. Could that have been it? What would have been different? I don't know. I don't know. So I don't question it. I know that God gave me a talent to mold and create. So that's just what I did.
Right. Now, Chanel, was your story similar in terms of your labor, delivery, pregnancy at all?
My pregnancy was pretty much normal. I had no, like, you know, underlying, there was no preeclampsia, no gestational diabetes, nothing. Mm-hmm. I basically just spontaneously went into labor at 33 weeks. They still don't know why that happened. So Jaden was born at 33 weeks and he was in the NICU for 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. I just, you know, just me thinking, I'm like, I always think that him being born premature had something to do with it. Mm-hmm. Now, over the years, Jaden has seen many different doctors for many different reasons, two of which are neurology and neurogenetics.
Right.
He did have genetic testing done some years ago, and they do have like different syndromes and disorders that are linked to autism. Fragile X syndrome is one of them. Mm-hmm. And I forgot what the other one was, but they do think that they have like some genetic markers that are associated with autism, but not something that's concrete.
Got it. Now, let me ask you this, Chanel, because you mm-hmm. have two children. Mm-hmm. Jada mm-hmm. is, as far as we know, not on the autism spectrum, right?
Possibly. Okay. She actually just had an early intervention evaluation about 2 weeks ago.
Okay.
And they did say that she does have some delays there. Okay. And also that she is showing some signs of autism.
Okay.
So it presented completely different.
I was going to say her.
In the beginning, like you would, like she was meeting all of her milestones and she was developing normally. So her doctors were never concerned. I was always concerned because I already had a child who was on the spectrum. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I, as a parent, was always concerned. Her doctors weren't, because in the beginning she wasn't showing any signs. And now she's starting to have, it's little things that most parents would probably look past.
Right.
But as a parent with a child who's already on the spectrum, you sit there and you criticize everything.
Right.
Like she has moments where she'll just run back and forth for like 10 minutes at a time. It's usually at the same time every night, but it's just running back and forth for like 10 minutes, or she's having trouble potty training. She's starting to like go back to baby babbling. And it's like little things that you may like that a normal or a typical parent may not think is anything big. Where I'm looking at it. Well,
you're hyper aware. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So, Akili, the term neurodivergence, can you just, for myself, my own edification, and for the people that will hear this when it goes out, what exactly does that mean?
So neurodivergent and neurodiversity are the two new buzzwords that are going around. Mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. what it's designed to do actually is just use new terminology to bring everybody together in inclusivity. It talks about the difference of your brain versus the difference of your disability. So if you're neurodivergent, your brain thinks differently than somebody else.
Okay.
So all that means is find out what we can do to support your brain versus mm-hmm. you have autism, so that means I know you need to go sit in a corner, a quiet corner, and stem or rock back and forth. That's what does your brain need for this situation? That's being diverse, and that's taking into account your brain rather mm-hmm. than a book to tell you how you feel or what you need.
Right. And that's different for everybody, right? Like,
yes,
everyone with autism. Different. Is just very, very different. Like my grandson, I believe, is on the spectrum, but they're reluctant to diagnose him because he's social, but he's socially inappropriate. You know what I mean? He doesn't have any concept of personal space or any of that. So because of that, but there are other like really clear markers to me that he's on the spectrum. But
and can I say that we have to be careful on how we use terminology because it presents so differently.
Yes.
My son is extremely social in sports. He was in sports from the time he was 4 years old. We put it in there because he had issues with hand-eye coordination. So we started with karate, we moved on to basketball, soccer, all the regular swimming. He took tennis for years. And then he ended up being a cheerleader, a collegiate cheerleader. So we're talking about in the middle of the stands, getting the crowd going, and then competing on that level, you know, in arenas.
Right.
Incredibly social. Soon as he walks off the floor, he's not talking to anybody.
Gotcha.
It's a different kind of how does it look? How does social look for you? And what does that mean? So it can't actually define your disability because your social presents the same as it does the next person because you're probably in another area having some difficulties.
Right. So Asperger's always fascinated me. When it was separate, because Asperger seemed to be, and this is for purely for lack of better terms, like the very low level of autism where, you know, someone with Asperger's could function in air quotes normally, but just had some, I don't even know what the term is. I don't know how to define these things. And I think that's part of the problem. I'm sorry.
Oh, no. I was just saying that normally when they said Asperger's, they would talk about your abilities, your intellect. And so it would get, you never knew what to say because the person is probably the smartest person in the classroom and understands, like my son was incredibly smart in math and science and all, you know, but he couldn't interact with his peers. That was his interaction with his teachers. Yes, he presents as incredibly intelligent, but part of intelligence is knowing how to have a conversation about what movie came out. That's part of the intelligence spectrum. And so as much as you can do, I think Asperger's is very difficult because they do a lot of masking to try and blend in because they really have no group subset to fit into because they might not present in one and not in another one. Or I think all of it's challenging, but I think that having not being able to wear your sign that says, hey, this is what's going on with me.
Yeah.
You know, I had to put my son in a car at 16 years old and teach him how to drive. And my biggest fear was, you know, him not understanding how to interact properly if he got pulled over.
Yeah.
And not for lack of trying, but then actually over trying and overcompensating, which then could bring on a whole new element.
Is that a problem? Yeah.
Right. And if I pulled up his school record, there would probably not be a judge in the world that would believe that he presented and did what he did.
Right. Oh, wow. It's so much to unpack this. I guess where I want to go next is if someone is listening to this and they're looking at their kid and they're thinking maybe there's a slight chance. And then let me first ask this question. So when we talk about spectrum, so are there grades or levels or how does it work? Like the spectrum that they determine that autism is now, this autism spectrum disorder, like is there your this level on the spectrum or that level on the spectrum? You know what I mean? I don't know if I'm asking it quite right, but
it changes. Like they've changed it. Actually, like within the last few years, I've seen them change it. I've had like, you know, low, moderate, severe, level one, level two, level three, high functioning, low functioning. I've heard it all. So basically, I guess you can look at ASD as like a color spectrum.
Okay.
where you can, like, you know, different color, like you can fall anywhere along that line of spectrum. Like you can have someone who's completely social and will talk, will chat your head off, mm-hmm. but can't do basic self-care functions. Or someone who is extremely, extremely intelligent and can recite every Shakespeare play ever written, but can't hold a conversation with someone for more than like a few seconds. It's like you can fall anywhere and have any combination of basically, I guess, disability within the spectrum. If there's no one, I don't think there's no one like concrete definition for like where people can fall in the spectrum, which is why they say if you know two autistic people, you just know two people with autism.
Right. Yeah.
That's it.
I like that. Yep.
You hit it the nail on the head, Chanel.
That was good.
That was perfect.
So let's talk a little bit about symptoms and what a parent or a teacher, but mostly parents, because that's who spends most of the time with the child, like when they're in from birth to say two. In that time frame, what can a parent look for without making them hypervigilant, like, oh my God, he's autistic. You know what I mean? What are some of, and I know that there's probably a list as long as my arm of possible symptoms and things, signs that you may want to take your child to be tested or evaluated, and either one of you can go first.
I had a bunch of them written down and I cannot find where I put them.
Okay, hate that. Well,
can I ask a question? Because I believe Chanel and I probably have a difference of opinion on this one, so it would be interesting to hear her take.
Yeah,
I'm not a proponent of going in for an immediate diagnosis, because I think it can lend to the crafting of more than the disability is. Mm-hmm. But I say that with a caveat. If you don't do early testing, you are mm-hmm. missing opportunities to get extra help. So mm-hmm. I say it knowing that the assistance is needed, but I think that sometimes we walk a fine line of trying to define child behavior and not allowing it to grow. But there mm-hmm. are some markers. My son didn't talk until he was five. Those mm-hmm. are some, there are some very, very telling markers. He never crawled. He wasn't able to do the motion of crawling. It wasn't that he couldn't crawl. It was he wasn't able to do that motion. And that's the difference. If you have a child that is crawling late, oh, well, so what? They're crawling late. If they don't know how to make their arms and their legs move in succinctly, then there you have the issue. So I think that I believe is the difference between going in and saying, yes, my child, I think that there is something that should be addressed, and trying to hold back. I too, Chanel, it's so interesting. I have two children also named Jared and Jasmine. So something with the J's. Something with the J's.
Yeah.
And when my daughter was born, I kind of did the same thing that you did. I was just holding my breath and looking and like, why she look that way? And then I noticed that some of the things she was doing was mimicking her brother, just mm-hmm. as a little sister. And mm-hmm. when I pulled back years later, of course, she's 29 now, and she doesn't have autism. She didn't ever have it. But there were times I could have steered that direction. So I think it mm-hmm. takes a strong parent. Well, it takes a strong parent to go through this anyway, but it mm-hmm. takes a strong parent to find the when to pull back. So yeah. I'm interested to see what Chanel thinks about that.
Okay.
I think I held back for a long time.
Yeah, you did.
With my daughter, I held back for a long time. And then going into her pediatrician, they're like, well, maybe it's worth, you know, just having her evaluated. I don't think it's necessarily, like, you don't necessarily have to go in for an autism evaluation. But if you notice that your child is like, I think one of the big things that people usually miss is when your child regresses. Like they met a milestone and they were doing this for a certain period of time and then they start to regress. God. Like they had words and they were talking and then they stopped, or they like slowly their speech declines until it's basically non-existent, or they were fully potty trained and then they cannot, you know, they can't use the toilet anymore. Like, but it doesn't necessarily have to be autism, but if you notice like little things like this, it's always a good thing to get an evaluation, even if it's just a developmental evaluation is another good thing to do, just to see, just to make sure that your child is, you know, developing as they should. I usually don't like to use the word normal. So like developing as they should, if they're not, what route should we go and things like that. Far as, I guess, symptoms for autism, again, every child is going to look different. Mm-hmm. There are like the telltale signs, like, you know, the big one is the flapping or things like that, but it's different stems. And honestly, most people stem in some type of way, tapping your pen on a desk, tapping your foot, rocking back and forth,
twirling your hair.
Yes. But it's where autism comes in is the repetition of it. Are you doing it for 20, 30, 40 minutes at a time, nonstop? You know, how, one of Jaden's big ones was lining up cars. He would literally just put all of his Hot Wheels cars in a line, lay on the floor and just look at them. Look at how your child is playing with toys. Are they playing with the toys appropriately? Are they just fixated on one aspect of the toy, fixated on the wheel spinning, fixated on, like, you know, like his biggest thing was anything that spun. Okay. Wheels, fans, anything that spun, he got fixated on them. I think like pretend play and parallel play is another one.
Hold up. You can't be throwing stuff like that out and not define it.
Yeah. Well, pretend play is usually like children, they have, you know, they can like having imaginary friends or pretending that they're a princess and, you know, their teddy bear is the prince and they have to come save him from the dragon. And like parallel play is playing basically the kind of the back and forth play between children. Jaden with his, cause he has a lot of cousins, a lot of the times would, instead of playing with the children, he would play next to them. He would be interested in what they were doing, but wouldn't fall into playing with them.
He would play parallel to them.
Yes, he would. Once he got to school, it was instead of he couldn't figure out how to integrate himself in school settings. So it was, he would always be interested in what they were doing, but couldn't figure out how to integrate himself in or how to ask to join in. And then the kids, like, they didn't really think anything. They just thought that that was his way of this. So they didn't really understand. And then that was like back in like kindergarten. So we were like five, you know? So it wasn't such a huge thing because he was interacting, but not necessarily how people would think that he would interact with other kids.
Got it. So to each of you, this question, is there a age, is two too young to actually make a diagnosis? What age, if there are some indicators, is a good age? And I know there's no right or wrong answer, because everything is case specific and specific to the child, but is there a point where, you know, you're missing out if you don't get them evaluated by this age? Or, and Akili, I know you kind of are more toward, let's wait a little bit and just see, you, the wait and see.
Well, I will say that, but we got our first conversation at 6 months old to say, I need you to understand there's some differences, and but we don't know what this is yet. And there was following along and until there was more concrete evidence. And I think that was even before 2 years old. But the steps after that was the most important steps. And this is where as a parent and as a very stubborn person, I wasn't aware how much the diagnosis could help the little things. My son was reading by the time he went from a non-speaker at 5 to, you know, reading high school books by the time he was in the third grade.
Nice.
But his comprehension was low.
Right.
Okay. So I was blessed to find a teacher that said, yeah, I got to take him all the way back to see Spot Run. And I was like, ooh, not really, because he's like a genius. Because by this, I mean, I don't know who you think he is, but by this time, he's speaking two languages. And why would you tell me that we need to go back to the beginning? And she said, I am seeing that his comprehension level doesn't fall along with the same way with the other children. Mm-hmm. Now, if it was science or any type of, yes, it did. But any other subject, just basic reading, no, his comprehension was off. Those outside professionals are the ones that can see your child the way you just cannot. Right. And that's my takeaway. As much as I say wait, my takeaway is you can only wait if you can listen to others. Because if I hadn't been guided by others, this would not have gone the same way at all. And so, because there was a lot of different avenues. So I think that as soon as somebody else besides yourself raises the red flag, just be aware of it. If you don't do anything about it, okay. But be aware that somebody said, I'm seeing something.
Right.
And there may be something here. And then from that point, what you do with it, that's you. But as soon as someone says that,
at least tuck it away. Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
So,
yes.
Talk. The segue in the diagnosis is perfect here, because who diagnoses? How do you get a kid diagnosed? Because now my niece and I live in two different states, close together, but different states. She's in Pennsylvania, in Philadelphia. I'm in New Jersey. The services where she is are far and away superior to what's offered over here. Trying to get a diagnosis for my grandson has been painful, to say the least, and he still doesn't have it. And just trying to get assistance and, okay, who gives the diagnosis? Is it a pediatrician? Is it a neurologist? Is it a developmental specialist? So if you guys could both just give some advice to people out there who are at the point where they're ready to have their child evaluated, and where did it go?
For me, it started with Jaden's pediatrician. At about 15 months, he started asking, well, is he speaking? Like, is he starting to try to form words? And I said, no. Mm-hmm. There is a like an assessment that the pediatrician give you called the MCHAT. Jaden failed his. I forgot what the score was. I would have to go back and look in his medical records, but he failed his.
Okay.
And he's like, okay, it's time to start going back. Because Jaden was actually receiving early intervention services since he was 3 months old, but they were more for like OT services, because they thought that he had torticollis when he was born, but it was just, he favored one side over the other.
Okay.
So after he had basically finished with his early intervention OT, they had a service coordinator that would check in every few months. At 15 months, his pediatrician was like, call ChildLink and ask them for him to be reevaluated. Mm-hmm. He got special instruction at 18 months. That really didn't go anywhere. He still wasn't speaking. He still was, he was doing all of the behaviors that the flapping, the spinning, the, running back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
So at about 20 months, he started with speech therapy. His speech therapist in the beginning thought that he would not speak. He just may never speak. And I think at his 2 year, right before he turned 2, he had gotten into the developmental psychology, meeting with a developmental pediatrician. Who was supposed to have started seeing him right after he left the NICU, but somehow he got missed in the system.
Okay.
So that's how I got my appointment so fast. But for most places, especially now, the wait list could be up to 2 years.
Damn. Really?
Yes. Yes. And that's just for any type of developmental evaluation.
Wow.
Now that, like, I know with Children's Hospital, it's 2 years. With Nemours, it's 2 years. Now, another thing, depending on state, through your children's health insurance, there's usually a behavioral and mental health, organization that covers that. Ours over in Pennsylvania in Philadelphia, is Community Behavioral Health.
Okay.
I can call them and find out, well, hey, where can I get an evaluation done? Okay. They can help schedule the appointments for the evaluation. They talk to the facilities that do the evaluations, which is how I got an evaluation for early intervention for Jada.
Got it.
But it would also, it would just depend on your state or your city that you're in. The first thing I usually would say to someone is talk to your child's pediatrician. They usually know more information than you think they know, but a lot of the times they're just waiting for you to ask. Sometimes parents can get a little defensive if someone is coming at them. Well, I think this is going on with your child.
Right.
No, my child is fine. There's nothing going on. Yeah. So their pediatricians are usually waiting for you to ask. They have the resources there. Or sometimes if you're getting insurance through welfare, the county assistance office could have some information as well.
Okay.
For Jaden, I went through Nemours developmental department. It was pretty fast from like the time I got the appointment to diagnosis. But in most cases, it's like a 2-year wait
for a diagnosis. So that's
for the evaluation appointment.
Oh, wow. So that's 2 years the child is missing.
Yes.
Maybe critical services. That needs to change. And yes. Akili?
I was blessed to be on a military base. Mm-hmm. We had some of the best medical care and then resource outsourced to other places. But I live here in Texas now. And 2 years would be a dream if someone got an appointment within 2 years and started services. Really? I mean, it could happen, but the onus is not on figuring out people's disabilities here and assisting them. We're just behind. We have a waiting list for services, for intense services. That's, I think it's over 25 years.
So
technically, if you don't get your child on before they're born, they're not going to get any dollars. And that's how bad it is in Texas right now.
Wow.
I'm not calling out Texas because Texas knows that this is what they, you know, this is what they do. But I raised my son and my daughter in Oklahoma, and we did not have these issues. They considered what was necessary for a child in the very beginning stages of life. Right. But I don't see the same thing here at all. And a lot of parents go into their own pockets. Their insurance doesn't cover everything you need. Because if you get one diagnosis, it might lead to another one. You might need PT, OT. There's so many things that you could need. Right. That you just, if you don't get them, it can delay another area. And so we're fighting a losing battle here in Texas, because even if they have one service, they're missing another service.
Right. So speaking of services, interventions, and support, I was reading about something called ABA, or Applied Behavior Analysis. Can both of you, if you have any, knowledge about it or experience with it, talk to me about its effectiveness. And I know early intervention with anything from cancer to ASD is a good thing, but the applied behavior analysis and therapies, what are they and are they effective?
I think you will have people on both sides of the fence saying yes or no at the effectiveness. Right. I think that in the very beginning, of course it's effective. I don't think that there should be any parent that isn't using or learning about some sort of ABA therapy. I don't see the fading of ABA therapy as they progress in school. And what happens, and I work with adults, so what happens is if you haven't trained your brain to figure out how to do those procedures independently, then you're still going to be relying on somebody to cue you with ABA therapy styles. And that doesn't happen in the workplace or in the adult settings. So the transition from ABA therapy into emerging adult, I think that's where the difficulty starts coming in.
So can you tell me just briefly what ABA therapies are? Are they a specific set of things that a child would do, or you know what I mean? Like, what is it exactly?
I kind of feel like it's along the lines of behavior modification. Mm. It's basically, from what I've seen, it's kind of showing a child how to handle certain situations or how to do things so that I feel like possibly so that they can fit in to a neurotypical world, because that's the world that they live in. Like, you can't sit there when you get frustrated. Yes, you can have a meltdown, but in the real world, is how many people are actually going to understand what is going on and how are they going to respond to you?
Right.
Jaden actually does have an ABA behavioral specialist that comes to see him at school. And Mr. Raymond, Jaden loves seeing him and, you know, him coming in and things like that. And he's working with Jaden. And he basically tries to get Jaden to be able to vocalize his needs when he's in class instead of just having a meltdown because of his frustration.
Got it.
You know, and his OT therapist does a lot of working with that as well. But Mr. Raymond, his specific job is to help Jaden with coping strategies and how to calm himself when he's having a meltdown because of his frustration in class and things like that. So it does work. Right. Now, on the flip side of that, it depends on the agency and the specific therapist, because some ABA therapists, I believe, strictly use behavior modification. Okay. And it's like, okay, no, this is what you're not going to do this. This is what you're going to do. Instead of telling them why one behavior is preferred over the other. It's like you'll have parents that are like that swear completely against ABA therapy. And then you'll have parents that are like, no, this was the only thing that works for my child. Nothing else worked. We've tried millions of therapies and strategies. So it's kind of a double-edged sword.
Right. And you know, could both be true?
Yes.
Completely. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yes. And I was going to say, Chanel, welcome to Texas, because there's a lot of behavior modification here. And to me, that's kind of insulting because it's not addressing the needs of their brain. Mm-hmm. And that's what I see a lot. And that's really, really frustrating, because there's certain things in their brain that are just not going to change.
Yes. Yeah.
So to ask them to change them is a punishment, and to say that you're not accepting, and to teach them how to start masking, and masking can take all different forms, especially with drugs or alcohol or the improper friendships when they get older. So they have to learn how to transition their somebody else cueing them to say, how do you want to handle this situation, to telling themselves, hey, what do I need to do? Oh, I need to go drop the F-bomb. Oh, that's right. I need to go to my car and do it. I just can't do it in here. But you could, if you that mad, go drop the F-bomb. I don't care. Just know where you can do it. Yeah, I tell my clients all the time, mad is an acceptable emotion. Use it, absolutely. Have it, have fun with it. Just know where you can have it. If you are mad and you're going to work, make sure you're at a 7, you know, on the scale going up. 10 is a perfect day. You're on a 7 by the time you walk in the door. Don't walk in the door because your day's not going to be good. You know?
Yep. So, Akili, you mentioned that the ABA doesn't really transition well as children go from child to adolescent to young adult to adult, and you do work with adults that have ASD. So can you talk to me a little bit about the challenges, the differences, and what your work entails in terms of, now you're an adult, you're 18 plus. So what does that work look like?
Well, from the numbers, one out of every 44 are being diagnosed with autism. Mm-hmm. 85% are unemployed or underemployed.
Okay.
With or without a college degree.
Okay.
So that means they're not going to work.
Right.
With all the hard work that our parents are doing throughout their whole life, the chances are they're not going to find a job. So the idea is to say, why is this happening? Because if they're getting the interventions that they need, and now that they're presenting and they're capable, they're still not being hired. So there are things that they are not understanding about how the world works.
Right.
So we have done so much focus on getting them to mesh with society and blend and all of these good things. We forgot to talk to them about their own internal happiness as it relates to the world around them. So the world doesn't work around you, you work around the world and you develop your happiness. They get thrown into this adult world and they're like, wait a minute. Right. Throughout my whole life, I had my parents doting over me. I had special IEPs in school. I had therapists. I had everybody surrounding me, helping me. Why am I alone now? I'm alone and I don't feel like I have anybody to help me through this new world. And I don't know that I heard about this new world the way I should have. So I deal with the young people that learned about sex through an anime game or show and have no idea because the parents said, no, they don't really think like that because they're really just not thinking like that.
Right.
They watched anime because the characters on anime are very animated. That's why these guys are starting. So if your child is watching anime, starts with anime, go look at the cartoons. They are very detailed in their presentation. So things like that, they're just not ready for the adult world. And then we start talking about their brain development. We are hard pressed to find any 18-year-old that is ready to get out in the world.
Right.
But a lot of people in the spectrum are functioning in maturity-wise on a lower level. So they need a longer time before they should be pushed into a different society like college and the work world. There, you can wait and strengthen some of their skills in the meantime, or work with someone like me who can get you to a career get you to a career path rather than your wiping tables at a restaurant for the next 10 or 15 years. This is a big struggle.
And the site actually has specific statistics on autism in adulthood, and I'm actually, while you were talking, was reading it. It says that over the next decade, an estimated 700,000 to 1 million teens will enter adulthood and age out of school-based autism services. Nearly half of 25-year-olds with autism has never held a paying job. And of the nearly 18,000 adults with autism who use state-funded vocational rehabilitation programs, only 60% left the program with a job. And of these, only 80% work part-time at a median weekly rate of $160. So That just really like confirms everything you just said, which is crazy. So they've got all these dope services from birth to 12th grade and then nothing.
Mm-hmm. And I'm private pay. I'm not state funded. So have me, it's private pay. And the reason why it's private pay is I do more. So you can go to a state funded program and they're gonna find you a job wiping tables. You're gonna say, what do I like? And they're gonna you're gonna say a quiet environment. They'll find you a little corner somewhere to wipe a table and they say they're great. And I will tell you, well, the world isn't quiet, so how much noise can you take?
Right.
Yep.
So let's go from there. And that is the difference of services as far, because here's the idea. You will have to take care of your child for the rest of your life, your natural life. And then once you pass, if you haven't invested well, then what's going to happen to your adult child?
Yeah.
They're not working. They're not going to work. They're not getting a job. So without that, this whole thing called life stops as soon as they become an adult. As soon as they're, just like you said, when they age out, their life in a sense stops. They continue to have social functions when their parents drive them somewhere. So then that's where they have their friends. Right. It is not a fun existence for an adult on the spectrum that has some deficits trying to figure out how to do this. It's scary to me.
Yes. Right.
Yeah, I agree. So what can employers and the folks who have the jobs to give do to do better by adults with autism? What can they do better? And the second part to that question, and that's for both of you, is what can legislation or government programs do better by the adult children? Because it's state by state, and I wish there was some national program so it wasn't regulated by states as to what services, like Texas is crappy, Jersey is crappy, PA seems to be really good. You know what I mean? So where can we go in terms of real solutions? Because the kids seem to be kind of covered. As long as they're in school, they're getting some services, maybe not ideal, but it's the 18 and ups. What can companies do, businesses do, and what can the government do better by our awesome folk?
I think for one, the government, and not just for individuals with autism, but for individuals with any type of mental health issue, the government needs to fund programs to train police officers on how to deal with these types of situations. Mm. I literally just had a talk with my husband the other day about when Jaden is of age to drive and how he may not understand what is going on in the situation when he gets pulled over. Yeah. So I'm like, I want him to literally have a card in a little pouch that he can slip through the crack of his window that says, I have autism spectrum disorder. I may not understand your questions. I may not answer your questions in the quote unquote appropriate manner. Here is all of my information, my license, my registration, and my proof of insurance. And please allow me to contact my parent on a video call so that you may explain to them why I am being pulled over so that they can help me better understand. Because a person with autism may not completely understand what is going on in the situation.
Right. Agreed. So,
the government has to find a way to better
train
police officers on how to deal with these types of situations.
So Chanel, my son started carrying his laminated card. I just made it on an index card when he was 14 years old. And when he started driving, I didn't have him put it in his wallet because I didn't want him to have to reach anywhere. Mm-hmm. So he took a little piece of Velcro and put the little Velcro on one sticky side, the other side, and put it on the dashboard. And that way he could just take it off the dashboard and hand it to them if necessary. Yep. So it was my only saving grace, but I held my breath almost every time for about 3 years while he left the house when he started driving. It was devastating every time he got behind the wheel. And I explained a lot of realistic, I visualized, so I had him watch TV shows and show him what would happen if you did, what would happen if, you know, why did the police officer react that way? I had him look in the mirror, because this was another thing. We pulled up mugshots, and I said, who do you look like? And he would point, and he's like, well, I kind of look like this person, that person. I said, okay, where were you at the same time that this guy was committing a crime? He's like, well, I don't know. And I said, well, that's not okay. Yeah. So you have to know, because if you can say that you look like a couple of these guys, so can an officer. And the officer technically is not wrong. They're just doing their job. And I think we are a long way away from our officers understanding autism. I don't think that we're anywhere near. And even if we do come to an understanding about autism, some of us, my son is 6'1", and he used to walk around at about 190 of solid muscle. He is not going to escape the ideas that he may be somebody different than he is. So we're a long way away. But as far as our employers, how can they do it better? I think we need to take a little bit of the pressure off of them, because they're not doing much right. Okay. And I mean that with all respect, because I have a ton of employers that do hire. They normally hire one, but a lot of them struggle with conversations or understanding. That's because they're not trained. They have so much. We kind of forget that they have big jobs to do. And they were wanting to hire somebody to help relieve some of that. And so one of their thought processes, which you know they don't say, is, well, why would I hire somebody and it's going to cause me more problems?
Right.
And you got to understand it from their perspective. That makes sense. They don't want to take an 8-hour day and turn their day into a 10-hour day. Yeah. And they're getting paid the same amount of money.
Yep.
So how can we as parents, as influencers, as voices, how can we make other people responsible? Like our government, like our school system. What if you know that a young person is not going to go straight to college, they need to do some sort of vocational training when they're a junior, probably a sophomore, junior, and senior year? Why are we still adding and subtracting when you don't understand how to work in a workplace? We've got to change what we're doing to help get people ready to enter that next stage.
Yes, I agree. I absolutely agree. So great segue. What, in an ideal world, if you had your way, what would that look like? That the programs to transition, what do you think should be in place?
You got to put it in the college for the teachers coming out of school, first of all. Because let's say in the college system, one of your classes that was mandatory, you guys remember taking the intro to college class, welcome to college, this is what you need to know.
Yeah.
What if in your sophomore year, because I don't think it should be in the beginning, I think it should be when you have more maturity, but what if in your sophomore year of college, you had to take a class, understanding differences, and it was based on disabilities. And so you had a whole semester to really dig into what that meant. Either you are going to become an employer one day, and now you have some knowledge. You have some actual knowledge of the difference, or you are the person that has a disability and you know you're included. So, and we have to put this back into the school system to have an educational conversation to all people. We can't have it with just a group. Everybody has to have, just like we're talking about CRT, or we have Black History Month, or we have, my kids had to have Oklahoma history to graduate from high school in Oklahoma. Okay. Why aren't we having, and you see what I'm saying? Could we have replaced that class with something that was,
absolutely, more useful?
And they would take that on with them, and they would use that experience to talk to others. So I think this really goes back to the school systems, which I know, bless their hearts, they're so busy and have so much else to do. But our colleges most definitely should have classes that are designed to teach inclusivity, and we don't.
Okay. All right. I wholeheartedly and 100% agree. Oh God, that hour went so fast. Oh my God. This is the part I hate when we're getting to, I'm looking at the clock like, we're at an hour already. So as we are coming to the end of our time together, I would like to get last thoughts from each of you in turn, just speaking directly to the people that will hear this show. What would you say to them on this subject, whether it's a parent or an adult out there with autism that's struggling to find their way? What would you say to them? And Chanel, she thought she got disconnected, so let's see if you're still with us.
I'm here.
You can go first. Okay, go.
Find your support, because dealing with all of this and all that autism comes with can be hard if you're on your own.
Yeah.
It could be, your support could be a friend, it could be a colleague, it could be a family member. Find your support. It could even be your child's therapist.
Mm-hmm.
I've always had, great relationships with all of Jaden's therapists. There was one particular OT therapist that he had. We loved her. And then he went to school. So, but support is a big thing. That could be for any parent. It doesn't have to be a parent with a child on the spectrum. It could be for any parent, but support is heavily needed. I think when you're dealing with a child with autism, I have a great support system.
Mm-hmm.
I have a great support system. People that are understanding and that are really accepting.
Right.
And in the real world, you may not always find people that are accepting of your child, because it's your child. Of course, you love them, but everybody else doesn't have to.
Right.
So when you can find people that are not only accepting of your child, but also of you and of the things that you do for your child, that is a great, great thing.
Yep, I agree. Great advice, Chanel. Thank you. And Akili?
Oops, I had to unmute. My final thought is probably off what I said earlier. So it's like, what is she talking about now? But I want parents, especially moms, to go look up the definition of the word selfish and start to apply that to their lives. Your life can not only be your child that is on the spectrum. And we fall into that so much because we don't have an understanding of what else to do. But self-care, oh my goodness, self-care along with finding your support. If you are not doing self-care, you are not being the best parent that you can for your child. And it is okay to hide in the closet and cry. Lock that door. I don't care if you have to do it once a week. Lock that door and sit in there and cry, laugh, eat the food that you want to eat that they say that they had to have. I don't care. Take some selfish time for yourself and be okay with the pattern and the path that this is going to take. Don't try and define it. Just be okay with the path that's going to take. This is going to take some, this is a roller coaster.
Yeah.
But that roller coaster always slides in the end,
Yes.
You go up and down and around, but it then slows down and slides in. My life is good. My son is amazing. He's a joy to be around. And I couldn't always say that, but now the roller coaster, we're just sliding in, and I'm not a parent anymore. I'm a confidant. I'm a friend. I'm his mom, but you know what I mean? I don't have to mother or raise him anymore. So my roller coaster ride is over. There is light at the end of this tunnel.
Yes. Oh, that's awesome. That was so good. Thank you so much. This has been a really, really, I always think coming into a podcast that, you know, I have my ideas for what it's going to be, and then it's always so much more. I can't thank the both of you enough. Chanel, I know that you literally probably still have packing boxes that need attention, and you took the time to spend this hour with me talking about this subject, not just for Jaden. You both are amazing advocates for your children, and that would be what I say to people is, you know, for a child that has ASD or any issue, we're their advocates. They can't speak for themselves, so we need to. And Akili, I appreciate you so much for remembering, because we scheduled this so long ago, and showing up and bringing all of your lived experience, your professional experience. Chanel, you know I love you to death. You're my niecey poo, so that goes without saying. So guys, as we wrap this up, there is a website, and I'm going to find some more resources to post in the show notes when the episode goes up. But the first one is autismspeaks.org. Their site is just a ridiculous wealth of information and resources, statistics. It's at least a starting point. If you live in a state like Akili and I, whose resources are lacking, this could be a starting point for you to at least start to do some research to maybe figure out your next steps in terms of your awesome child. So show notes will include Akili's information and Akili's Corner social media website. It will also include the Ausome Swag website. And I want everybody that listens to this to go buy something. I mean it, or I'm banning you from the podcast. No, I'm just playing. The episode is going to post the last Friday in April, because I need time to edit. And it will post with show notes and a transcription for those folk who are hearing impaired. You'll be able to read what we talked about. It will be available at www.thecandidshop, and that's Kandid with a K, .com. And while you're over there listening to this awesome episode, like, follow, share, subscribe, follow us on Facebook and IG at the Kandid Shop Podcast, or our YouTube channel at the Kandid Shop. Thank you, ladies, again. It has been my absolute pleasure to have this conversation with you. Thank you for joining me.
You're very welcome.
Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you. All right, guys. Like I say at the end of every single episode, I want you all to keep it safe, keep it healthy, keep it candid, and this time I want you to keep it awesome. Good night.